Hi and welcome to this new video. My name is Sebastian and I'm a Dutch driving instructor for Streetwise. So in this video we're gonna do it a little bit differently than a normal because we're gonna do this video in English. So before we start the video I want to apologize for my English. Sometimes I speak a little bit like Louis van Gaal, but I hope everybody can understand me and I don't mess it up too much. So in this video we're gonna do a Dutch driving test. That means that I'm going to show you what a Dutch driving test contains and what you should do to pass it. Now, of course, before we start the test, we be here right on time, of course, to make don't stress out too much. But once we got caught by the examinators, they ask you a few questions like what do you expect from the test and what do you think you have to do to pass it. Now, of course, the main things you have to do is drive safe and drive on your own. If you can do those two things, then you'll pass the test, of course. So the other thing is when we start driving, the test contains three things. It's like driving on instructions, like going left, going right, going the roundabout, go left, go right there. And the other thing is special maneuvers like parking, turning the car around. And the last thing is driving on the navigation. So those three things you have to do on the test. And in what order, that depends on the examinator, but you have to do those three things. Do them safe, do them on your own, and then you'll pass, of course. So, before we start this, don't forget to hit the like button to help the YouTube algorithm. And if you aren't subscribed yet and you would like to see more videos in Dutch, maybe some more in English, but mostly Dutch, then hit the subscribe notification, of course, as well. And let's start the video. So we are at the Dutch driving facility at Eemnes here. It's like a little CBR, so it's not a big test location and there's a lot of construction going on right now, so it looks a little bit shabby. But yeah, let's do this. So the first bit is usually when you do the Dutch driving test, it is like following the instructions of the examinator. Then we get to like a zone of like a village, we do some parking there, maybe turning a car around, and then we drive back to the CBR with the navigation. And once we get back, you will hear the end result and you have heard of your passed or not. So my car indicates that I have still 80 kilometers action radius, if I say it correctly. That's enough for the test. Usually it's about a 30 minute drive and it will be like 20 kilometers. You don't drive that fast that often. It's a little bit highway, a little bit in the built area, of course, the two special maneuvers, so you'll be back before you know it. So for all people that watch it outside of the Netherlands, I'm a little bit curious how the Dutch driving test is going on there. So let me know in the notifications if you have a cool story about your driving test, or maybe the Dutch driving test in other locations go quite differently. So let me know. I'm interested. Okay, we're in a 30 zone right now, so that means that the first junction is equal. So I have to give people from the right the priority. So I have my foot above the brake and the clutch. I look to the left and the right. I stop for people that come from the right with a vehicle that drive a car. So I stop here and let the car go first. Next time we leave a 30 zone. Every time we leave a 30 zone, I would recommend to go to first gear. We have to give the priority to left and right. There's nobody there. So we go left here and then we drive away. And we always do an after check. So when we leave a junction or a roundabout, we look in our inside mirror to see what's going on behind us. Of course, every junction or splitsing, that's a Dutch word, like T-bone junction, let's give it a name. You look left and right, of course. On the roundabout, we go left. So I look in my inside mirror, outside mirror, and over my shoulder so I can indicate. I indicate left, go to second gear. We do all roundabouts in second gear. I let the car roll, so I have my foot above the brake and the clutch, and I just go after this red car. So when I leave the roundabout, I look over my shoulder and indicate to the right. So I'm gonna leave here. Over my shoulder, indicate right, and leave the roundabout. So I do an after check, because I left the roundabout, I always check what's going on behind me. We go to fourth, and then we go to Utrecht. So we go inside, outside, and shoulder, because we're going left. And now we're switching lanes, so I do it again, inside, outside, and shoulder, and we switch to the left lane. I'm gonna prepare the car, go to third gear, because it's a wide corner, and I can probably see through, there's nobody there. So I look over my shoulder and turn into this corner. Of course, I just want to apologize for my English of sometimes. Sometimes I speak a little bit like Louis van Gaal, but I do my best and hopefully I can help a lot of people. Okay, let's see, we're going to the highway. So the maximum speed at the moment is still 130. And in a few months, it will drop down to 100. 100, that's the slowest in the European Union. But of course, we have to meet the carbon dioxide requirements. So yeah, it sucks, but for now we still can drive 130, so that's quite quick. So we go to the left here. We always, when you approach a highway, make sure that you go onto the highway, and sometimes maybe you have to go to Amsterdam. You can later go off, of course, but it's safer to go on first, especially if you don't know the way. If you don't go onto the highway and at the end you recognize that there is no exit there and it's only going on, yeah, you will fail the test because you went on too late. Now, when we drive on the highway, try to drive the maximum speed and always stick so much to the right as possible. And when you switch lanes, always look in the mirrors and indicate properly. So we're gonna follow Amersfoort from now. At 300 meters in advance, you have to indicate that you're going off and of course be on the right lane. I see Amersfoort, the sign is over there, so I stick to the right lane right now and I follow this traffic. I'm at 300 meters according to the sign, so I look in my mirrors, inside, outside, shoulder, and I indicate for going right. Now, I have to switch lanes here, so I do again the inside, outside, and shoulder, just to make sure that it's nobody next to me. When you're driving on an exit, we're going to Amersfoort right now, and the arrows indicate to the right, you start decelerating the car and start braking. Because it's a blind corner, you can't see where the end of the corner is. We go to fourth gear and we want to do that before we are at the end of the squared markings and at the verdrijvingsvlak is the Dutch word, like the point. I'm not sure how to call it, verdrijvingsvlak in English, but you will understand what I mean. So we go to fourth gear there. We stay in the corner, we keep it in fourth. That's a nice gear to accelerate in when you once you get out. There was a split of highways. That was the green and white sign, like a Christmas tree. That means that there's a split. So we'll go off this highway and go onto another one. So in fourth gear, we have a lot of power. The car will pull quick enough. So we look in the mirrors again, inside, outside, shoulder. We indicate to the left and we go onto the highway. And we just look once more, just to double check. We go to fifth gear and we will leave the highway at Soest and Baarn Noord. So I see here, this is a high priority sign. It's Soest and Baarn Noord without any distance anymore. So it's indicate here and make your decision now. So I made my decision to go right. Of course, people on this highway, that's also a split, know that I'm going to be going right and they can consider me. So first lane we switched, we always one and then the next one. So we go inside, outside, shoulder, indicate to the right, and then we slowly shift to the right lane. Now, once we're here, I see the sign out, that means exit. So I go back to fourth gear again, because it is a blind corner. So I slowly let go of the clutch, and I let the car roll into the corner. I stay behind this car, and I see the signs, we're going Eemnes, Baarn, Soest, it's going left. So I stick behind the car with the trailer, because if I look to those signs, I see there are two lanes for going left, so I can stay in this lane. So it's not, yeah, you don't have to overtake if you don't want to, and don't make it harder for yourself than necessary, of course. So we stay behind this car. If this car wasn't here, we went to third gear, because it's a big corner, it's like a wide corner, we can properly see through. It's a traffic light that signals left, so that means that there are no other cars or traffic that has the same also has green that can obstruct us. So there's nobody else going at the same time as us. So if the light was green, I would have went for third gear. But of course now we have to go for red light, so we have to stop the car. So coming out of the corner, I do an after check. So look at my mirrors to see if everything went fine. So we're going Soest and Baarn. The traffic sign says two lanes for going straight. So I stick behind this trailer. And the same thing is, there was like the right lane was free. So the left lane got onto the roundabout, but the right lane was free of the roundabout. So I don't go to second gear in this case, because I just have a free pass here. So now we leave the roundabout, so I look in my mirrors and we go to the left lane. So we look inside, outside, shoulder. The left lane is free because I want to go to Baarn. And Baarn is on the left side of the roundabout, so I place my car on the left lane. Again, check the mirrors, indicate for going left. It's a roundabout, I take all roundabouts in second gear, because I go on the roundabout in this case, so I can go on. I have the third exit, so at the second exit I have to switch to the right side of the roundabout, so I indicate right. Oh, the car behind me sticks on the right lane, that was a mistake on his part, but I could have made it, but for this time I want to see what to do when the car on your outside doesn't do it correctly. Because you have to sort the car on the inside for going left. So he made a mistake on the outside, he was lazy. That's not the way to do it, you should switch here. So you can block those cars on this side of the roundabout and then we take the roundabout here. So if you have this on your test, make sure that you stay on the inside and don't cut the other one off, even though he made the mistake. So we go straight here. We're on a 50 road, we are inside the billet area on a priority road, and you can see that with, of course, with the yellow diamond sign. So we go right there, and because it's a 50 road, the sign is in front of the junction, so that means that the side street is right after the sign, because we're inside the billet area. If we were outside the billet area, the sign would be behind the junction, so I had to go in front of the sign to go right. So we have no visibility here, there's nothing to see from the right, but I have to give them priority. So I go to first gear. Of course, I always check the left side and go really slowly here. We left the junction, so I do an after check and we go right. So I check my mirrors again and over my shoulder to go right. And then we go left here. So indicate, inside, outside, shoulder, we indicate. People from the right, people from the left. Traffic that goes straight has priority, but the guy walking there is too slow. Oh, and now I can't go anywhere, so I stop the car. The girl stops over there as well, so she gives me the priority, and I thank her for that. And because of the other lesson car with the trailer there, I was standing in the middle of the corner. I couldn't see anyone coming, so make sure if something happens like that, stop the car, keep it safe, and then you'll have no issues on the test. It's better to stop and wait to see what the other car is doing than just keep on going and get your priority on your own. So we're gonna do a 3-point turn here. I stop the car. I look around if there's nobody there. And what we'll do, we'll drive slowly and steer all the way in until we hit the curb on the other side of the road. So I go very slowly. And then at the last second, when the car dives down, because it's a barrel-shaped road because of the watering. So the road, the car dives down now. I turn the wheel back straight and I slowly tap the curb. When I hit the curb, I put it in reverse. I look around, nobody there, so I turn the car around. And once the car is straight, so in a 90 degrees on the road, I wait 2 seconds, 21, 22, and now I turn the car back, hit the back at the curb, and then I turn around, just look around, indicate, and then you're off. Again, we did something, this we do an after check. We look around us to see if everything went fine. So that was the 3-point turn. It's quite easy, if you know what to do, of course, and you have control over the car. So we go left here. A car from the other side is going straight, so I have to give them the priority. Because I make a turn, they go straight. Also, I have to look out for people from the right. There's nobody there. Not sure why they stopped. It was not necessary, but of course. A lot of learner cars here, because it's like the test area, and because the examinators do a lot of bijzondere verrichtingen here, so special maneuvers. All learner cars, of course, and the instructors practice here as well, so you get familiar with the area and the things they ask on the test. For here, we go right, so again, I check my mirrors, indicate, inside, outside, shoulder, indicate for going right. Once more, inside, outside, shoulder, and we go right. Just a little, I just want to give you 3 points. I stopped the car here just to explain a little bit. We watch in the mirrors on 3 occasions. And if you do that on 3 occasions, you do it every time. So every time we want to signal, we have to look in the mirrors first. So every time I want to signal left or right, I look in my mirrors first and then I signal. The second occasion is every time I go left or right. Yeah? So if I say we go right, I have to check my mirrors first, indicate. Then I will closer to the junction and I have to look again because I'm turning the car left or right. So I do a double check essentially. And the last thing is every time I want to move my car on the road. So like example, there's a car standing in front of me. So I have to move to the side, inside, outside, shoulder. At the end, I want to go left on the junction. So I do inside, outside, shoulder. I indicate left. Then I have to move my car here to the right, inside, outside, shoulder. And then again, inside, outside, shoulder for turning left. So yeah, as you can imagine, there's a lot of, if you do it in the practical side, when you get your license, you think, what the hell is he doing? But for the test, you want to see that you're capable of following the rules. Yeah, so I understand, if I drive on my own, I have my driving license, I'm an instructor as well, of course, but I don't do it all the time inside, outside, shoulder. I do it where it's necessary, of course, but for the test, be as precise as you can and try to follow the rules as much as you can. Now, we're still on a priority road. We can drive 50 here. What is important that you look always to the left and the right when you go over a junction. So every time you cross a junction, you look left, forward, right, forwards. And you do that as many times as you need. That is every time you go over a junction, you have to at least look at the junction, even though you have the priority. So it's not like, oh, I have priority, I don't have to look. Of course, you have to look every time you go over it. So still on a priority road, still going 50. Every time the priority road sign is in front of the junction, so I look to the right, yes, nobody there. There's another sign here, so that means there is a junction as well. And also there is like a zebra crossing for people that walk to pass and do that safely. So I go left, there's a junction here. So like a one-way street, so I could have known that was a street there. And because of the sign that says there's a priority road, because those signs are only in the nearby location of a junction. So again, there's a sign there. Now, for example, we go left, inside, outside, shoulder. I go back to second gear because third gear is not an option because I can't see clearly what's going on here. And I don't have the priority for going left. Maybe someone comes out, so I have to see what's going on. I do have the priority, of course, but it's not safe because I don't have any visibility. So third gear drops and I go to second gear. I think I forgot to double check. It's inside, outside, shoulder for indication, and then inside, outside, shoulder when you want to turn left. So again here, inside, outside, shoulder, indicate. Now I want to make a right-hand turn. Inside, outside, shoulder, just to double check. Foot above the brake and the clutch because I can't see what's going on here. So every time you let the car roll, have your foot above the brake and the clutch so you can stop at any moment possible. Of course, do your after checks when you leave roundabouts, junctions, when you do special maneuvers. Always look around you and see what's going on. On the left side here, there is a junction again. So I have my foot above the brake and the clutch. We go right, inside, outside, shoulder. Oh, I forgot to indicate. I was a little bit late, but doesn't matter too much as long as you're consistent. We're doing it right, of course, and not doing it too late every time. Look left and right, equal junction. Okay, on the roundabout we go straight. We go to the other side. My foot above the brake and the clutch. I have to brake and stop if there's somebody coming, so I stop here. They go off the roundabout, so I go on the roundabout. Nobody here. When I leave the roundabout, look over my shoulder, indicate for going right. There's a car standing to the left side of the right side of the road, so I have to move to the left, inside, outside, shoulder. And because I make a move to the left side of the car, and I move back to the right side, so I move back. Sometimes, if it's like a bigger road with a vehicle that's standing mirror in the middle of the road, sometimes you want to indicate. It's not necessary all the time because it's quite clear that I'm going around him. But at least I have to look in my mirrors because sometimes it's possible that a bike, we are in the Netherlands, that a bike overtakes you. Especially the e-bikes, e-scooters, just name it. They are all over the place and we have to be really careful that we don't make any mistakes with them because they are quite weak in traffic, of course. So we go left now, inside, outside, shoulder. I indicate for going left. The car on the other side has to wait because of the truck. I can go in this street. It's a one way, so I have to be really careful, drive slowly because it's quite narrow. And then I see a sign for pedestrians in front of me, and the sign is quite a little bit hidden here behind the trees. It says for going left, so I go inside, outside, shoulder, and I go left. I have to watch out here because I have to, of course, still it's an equal crossing of a junction, so I have to prioritize people from the right, but there is nobody there. Now I drive away, go to second gear, and of course do the after check. There's quite a small street here again, so drive slowly, be cautious, maybe for people that are coming from this side. Foot above the brake and the clutch. I have the priority because I was I came from the right side. It's an equal junction, so you give people from the right priority. Okay, we go around this bike, so we look in my mirrors, go around her, and then we go right. So I look again in my mirrors, inside, outside, shoulder, indicate to the right. I go back to first gear because I can't see properly. There's like a big speed bump here and I don't want to fly out of the corner onto the side of oncoming traffic. So second gear again, look in my inside mirror. Of course, always do your after checks, foot above the brake and the clutch. We stop for people from the right because it's still equal. We're in a 30 zone, and 30 zones, you can recognize them by equal junctions inside the builded area. Once we are outside the builded area, an equal junction becomes a 60 road. So for now, we still stay at 30. I have my foot above the brake and the clutch. Look to the right. There's a bike coming from that side, so I stop. I'll wait for this woman to go. It makes it more clear, when you wave to somebody, when you can go, she's immediately she's certain of what she can do or what she can't do. I could have also get like gelegenheidsvoorrang. Let's find the English word for that. That's opportunity priority. That's a really weird translation. It means that because of the bike was coming from the right, but she had to stop from oncoming traffic from my side. So everybody had to give the priority to each other, and that was a reason for me to continue because the bike had to stop. But because of the bike from the other side, that was a bike, I couldn't take the risk and made a mistake, or maybe I did it right, but she didn't see it. So I stopped the car here for the zebra crossing, of course looked to the left and the right. She's far away enough for me to continue. I don't bother her by going in front of her. And then we go left here, inside, outside, shoulder, indicator to the left. Once I'm gonna turn in the car again, so inside, outside, shoulder, I make a big corner instead of his small corner, so he has the priority on me, as well as the traffic from the other side. So I look over my shoulder. People are looking at me funny because I have a camera on my head, I understand. I look like some kind of Teletubby. Not sure if everybody overseas know what it is, but it's like a Dutch TV show for small children, like babies and stuff like that. They all have like a weird thing on their head. But yeah, sometimes a little bit awkward driving around with a camera on my head, but usually I drive so people don't see it. But sometimes when they look at me, yeah, it's still a little bit weird, but of course, we'll make it work. And then there's like a obstacle here on the road, so I have to look at my mirrors to go around it. Of course, wait for the traffic from the other side. They have priority on me, but because of the bikes, it's quite slow, of course, here. So we have to wait, of course, wait for a few seconds. It's quite busy, but we have to wait. Now we can do this, inside, outside, shoulder. We go around it, inside, outside, shoulder, and we're away. Okay, still a 30 road, the junctions were equal here, but now we get on a priority road. It's end of 30 zone, so it's a 50 road from here. Of course, I have to be cautious for the zebra crossing, and then we stick with 50. Look left and right every time you cross a junction, so there's a sign here. Everywhere where signs are our junctions, so we look to the left and right, and at the roundabout we go right. So I look in my mirrors, inside, outside, shoulder. We indicate for going right and we slow the car down. So I start braking, go back to second gear, release the clutch slowly, look in my right side mirrors over my shoulder, and stop the car here for cars that are on the roundabout. Nobody here, I leave the roundabout, look over my right shoulder, nobody there. Okay, and let's find a place to park the car. I'm not gonna do this in this street. I want to show you reverse parking today, and then the test is almost done. We're gonna navigate back to the CBR. We're going left. Hopefully there's some spots there. Not sure yet, but we're gonna reverse park if possible. Yeah, it's possible, so we're gonna do that. And I'm gonna teach you the crash method. It sounds a little bit strange, but it is a parking method when there are not enough spaces to park the car in reverse with the three line method. That's maybe something for a different video. We're gonna do one today. Crash method means that I have to place my the rear of my car equal to the beginning of the side of the blue car. I want to park against next to the blue car. I will show you guys. So my rear of the car should be around the line of the blue car. So I'm gonna place my car here, and now I'm going to reverse the car in. I think the guy there thought, what the hell is he doing with the camera on his head? So I'm gonna place it next to the blue car because the rear of my car was equal. I'm just gonna drive away because he wants to take his car, I think. But the rear of my car was equal to the side of his car. So yeah, that was about it. But yeah, it's a little bit awkward, of course, me with the camera on my head parking to a guy that wants to get his car. But that was like parking in reverse. I'm gonna do it here once more for you guys, so you can see it a little bit more slowly. So I'm gonna lay the back of my car equal to the side of his car, and then turn the car all the way in. I can see in this mirror if it's going all right or not. So I drive slowly. You have to go quite close to him. You see that I'm growing really close. And then I steer the car back in all the way, of course. Set my wheel straight, and then I'm next to him. If you want to see my parking videos, I'd love a lot more detailed, of course. But it's like for a test video, I do it quickly to show you guys what's going on a test. So I'm gonna do, let's see. We're gonna do parking of navigation. Come on, let's go, car. Okay, we're gonna quick travel, new traveling goal. The latest is always the CBR. So we're gonna do the red
routes worden berekend.
So yeah, I'm gonna translate the navigation as well for you guys. So they're gonna calculate the routes. We're gonna always do the red one because that's the quickest and the easiest one. So it's 8 minute drive and it's quite easy usually. We don't drive to the center of Amsterdam. It's quite an easy route on the on the navigation. And for me, I always like to listen and I don't like to watch to the signals and to the screen. If you listen, it's a lot easier.
Over 100 meter de rotonde bij de eerste afslag verlaten naar de inweg.
And 100 meters leave the roundabout at the first exit. Yeah, take the first exit. Okay, so we take the first exit at the roundabout. I look in my mirrors, indicate we're going right at the roundabout. Of course, I have to give the priority to the people on the roundabout. When I leave the roundabout, I look over my shoulder for my blind spot, and then we take off. We are on 50 road right now because I see a priority sign. In 400 meters, leave the roundabout at the of the first exit and follow the same road. So you can also see it in my screen, but we follow just the roundabout first exit. That's important. Remember first exit. You look at the sign. Okay, first exit is straight, obviously. So yeah, just follow this. Roundabout, all roundabouts.
Afslag en daarna de volgende rotonde op de derde afslag verlaten.
All roundabouts, second gear. When we leave the roundabout, always indicate, even though there's a big separation here of lanes. So I indicate for going right. And the next roundabout, we leave at the third exit. Okay, easy, third exit.
Over 200 meter de rotonde bij de derde afslag verlaten en de A1 volgen.
So again, third exit. It gets a lot.
De derde
again, third exit. Sometimes it get a little bit crazy. But at some level, yeah, some students still can't figure it out. So for all guys and girls, of course, that want to drive the Dutch driving test and have difficulty with navigation, try to listen more and pay less attention to the screens on your dashboard.
De loop van de weg voor 2 kilometer volgen, alstublieft.
Normally speaking, you also listen to your instructor or your examinator for the biggest part of the test. So it would be weird if you start looking to the dashboard with the navigation because it only distracts. So we make a lot of speed going to the highway because there's a lot of room available, so I want to get my pace before I'm at the highway. Because I'm driving quite quick at the moment, already 120, there's enough room for me to overtake this truck, but I have to consider the car on the left lane there. So I have to follow right to Hilversum. So stop looking at your screen, start looking at the signs and listen, guys, come on. You always mess it up by listening or by watching too much to the screen. You can't see what's going on around you. So we switch lanes. That's 100 here. Oh, and my cruise control is still set on 140. And we go to the right. Because there's no speed difference anymore. So when you drive on the highway, try to look around as much as possible so you can see what's going on. So drive right now, yeah, perfect. There's two lanes for going right, so I'm fine where I am at the moment. And still I have to follow Hilversum. It's in my head still from what my direction was, and it's still in the middle of the screen, Hilversum. So we're following that.
Over 350 meter rechtdoor rijden richting Hilversum.
And 350 meters to go straight to Hilversum. Now, of course, that's easy as well. I indicate for going right. Stay on the right lane when it's possible. Cruise control set to 100, so cruising along, looking in my mirrors to see what's going on around me. In 900 meters, drive right and follow Almere. Now, that's also quite easy. I look around me, there's an entrance here on the highway, so I want to look if there's somebody entering. Going right to Almere, two lanes. I go to the right lane, of course, when there are multiple lanes and the right lane is free. Still following Almere, I keep my hands on the wheel at the proper location. Yeah, still drive right, okay, easy. In 300 meters turn right and follow Almere. So like this is a high priority sign because it says Almere right. There's no meters anymore on the sign, so you know, okay, I have to exit the highway there. So you can indicate 300 meters in advance. The navigation said 300 meters. The sign was visible, so you're around 300 meters. So enough, again, to know what you have to do. So we have to go to Eemnes. And some people are a little bit confused here and understand, because the sign that's over there says Eemnes 1,000 meters. Every time you're not sure, you have to go onto the highway, you go onto the highway. That's safer. You can better go onto the highway and maybe overtake some people, or you can stick to the right side, of course. But yeah, that truck is driving so slow, I wanted to overtake him. But it's better to go onto the highway than make a mistake and figure out at the last second that the highway ends, or the entrance ends. So you want to go onto the highway, then you see the arrows here that you can go right. You know that you have to go to Eemnes, that's going right. So now I'm for sure that I can go and leave the highway. Oh shit, that's my music, otherwise I get a copy claim. And so now, for now, for sure, we know that we can go right. I'm going back to fourth gear. Let go of the brake and the clutch before we go into the corner. And a few hundred meters turn right to the Zuider Single, of course, no problem. Inside, outside, shoulder, we indicate going right. There's a junction here, I'm not 100% sure that I can flow through. So second gear, I let the car roll into the junction, I look to the left. The navigation side right and then turn right immediately again. So getting out of the corner, after check. Check my mirrors here again. Looking over the shoulder. Turn right into Bramenberg. Look over my shoulder again. Oh, look left and right. And then we go straight.
U heeft het reisdoel bereikt. Het reisdoel bevindt zich aan de rechterzijde van de weg.
Okay, we met our traveling goal, so we're at the location of the CBR again. And just to make it a little bit easier for ourselves, the last bit is quite narrow. So we go around this car, look around us. Perfect place to stop the car as well. And this is, we are back at the CBR. So this was a Dutch test route, of a Dutch exam route, however you want to call it. This is what you have to do for the Dutch test. Indicate going left and right, whatever the examiner says. Then we do two special maneuvers. We did a 3-point turn, and we did parking in reverse. And the last bit is driving on navigation and driving back. So the test takes around 35 to 30 minutes. I'm not sure how long it took for this one, but it's around that, I guess. Yeah, this is it for this video. I hope you liked it. I hope that my English wasn't too bad. I would like to see you at the next one, and please consider to subscribe and leave a like. And yeah, until next one. Bye.